Hello, ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Richie from lawfulrebellion.org. Welcome to another Lawful Rebellion podcast. Today I have with me Freeman Michael from freetheplanet.net.
I think the best way to introduce my research into mortgage law is to say that I come at this without any emotional attachments because I don't have a mortgage in any of my names. So there's no self-interest here. Even though I am representing the interests in a mortgage-related matter of my own family, none of the interests are specifically mine. Nevertheless, because I come at it from that kind of perspective, because I'm not up against the kind of pressure that most people involved in mortgage issues are under, and this is the kind of pressure that can see people buckle into things like nervous breakdowns and all kinds of physical ailments, because the pressure is relentless when you're in that situation. And the most surprising thing about mortgage law in this country, let's just put the rest of the world and what's going on in the US to one side. What's going on in this country is mortgage law is not being applied for the benefit of the people. It's being applied only for the benefit of the banks. And the evidence that this is happening is contained in a very explicit statute called the Law of Property Miscellaneous Provisions Act 1989. Section 2 of that act prescribes that every single mortgage contract must contain all of the terms and conditions which have to have been expressed in advance of the execution of the contract and agreed between the parties, individually negotiated. That document also has to bear the signature of the mortgagee, the bank, and the mortgagor, the customer. And if it does not, that mortgage contract is null and void. And the legal effect of a null and void mortgage contract since 1989 has been to render the situation as if no mortgage arose, which means the legal charges that arose from any mortgage contract which falls foul of Section 2 of the 1989 Act are automatically considered nullities. However, unless the mortgagor is able to demonstrate this sufficiently to the land registry will just presume that the mortgage, i.e. the charge that they're holding on their register for the benefit of the bank, is a valid one. Now, because of this, quite a few people in this country over the last 6 to 9 months have attempted to obtain court orders directing the land registry to remove the unlawful charges from the register. And thus far, I'm not aware of anyone being successful doing this. From my own perspective, I've been involved since February 2010 in a matter between one of the oldest banks that's been getting away with fraud on these islands and a family property trust. And the issue began when the family property trust, in good faith that a mortgage of property arose from a genuine bona fide loan of money from the bank, they presented a promissory note made payable to bearer, which is just as good as cash. Regardless of what people will tell you, especially members of the legal professions, but we leave that to one side for the moment, that this was presented to a director of the bank. The bank, over the period that followed, refused to accept the note on two occasions and claimed that nobody at the bank or at the banking group which owned the bank had any cognizance of a transaction which involved the deposit of a promissory note made payable to bearer into a private trust account in order to create a line of credit which is transferred into a public account where it can be accessed. Now, for them to do that, they will have to have no knowledge of an Act of Parliament that was specifically dealing with the business of that very bank. And the bank we're talking about is the Bank of Scotland. And the Act we're talking about is the HBOS Group Reorganisation Act 2006, which specifically states in one of its schedules that the business of the bank includes, without any limitations at all, the business of accepting promissory notes on deposit for purposes that include the settling of any and all liabilities, and the HBOS Reorganisation Act is probably the closest to an accurate description of the modern business of banking. What they do in that act is they lay it on the line exactly what their business is, because they were splitting up each bank that became part of the group. They were consolidating assets, so they also wanted to share equally all of the business of the bank. So they expressed it in the statute which reorganized the banking group.
So, hold on. I mean, as soon as you say that, trust jumps out at me.
It expresses in that statute that the bank can be trustee of any and all types of negotiable instruments and non-negotiable instruments.
Why did they have to put that into an act?
You know, that's the question that I've often asked, and never quite being able to come up with a plausible answer. The many legal researchers right across the world over the course of the last decade who've proven beyond doubt that the law states very clearly that promissory notes are just as good as cash in certain circumstances. And the law prescribes this very, very clearly in the Bills of Exchange Act and in subsequent pieces of case law. Lord Denning in the Court of Appeal, he basically said, in the words to the effect of, it's been said many times in this court, meaning the Court of Appeal, that a promissory note is as good as cash unless there's a good reason to the contrary. And a good reason to the contrary is that you are contractually bound not to pay with a promissory note. However, that contractual obligation will be deemed unconscionable because in equity, nobody can be prevented from using a lawful means of payment. There are certain promissory notes which are different to promissory notes made payable to bearer. If it's made payable to bearer, the maker of the note is considered to be accepting the note upon signature. And then as soon as it's delivered to the payee, the value of the note has been transferred by signature and delivery. The only difference between a promissory note made payable to bearer and a banknote made payable to bearer is the banknote can be reissued again and again after payment, whereas the private promissory note is retired after it's fulfilled its purpose. However, the banks aren't retiring them, and they're not supposed to sell them on either, or bundle them up and sell them on, as they have been doing. And this led me to deepen my research in the mortgage law, and I was searching for the definitive case law to rely upon, and I found a case called the Saheed case. And the Saheed case was basically, it was two bankers arguing over a property which one of them had a charge over, and the defining argument of the case was the argument that I've already put forward under Section 2 of the Law of Property Miscellaneous Provisions Act 1989, because there was no contract with the signatures of both parties, there was no mortgage, and the charge fell. So when I found that, I thought, this has surely got to be enough, because we were involved in court proceedings against the Bank of Scotland. We filed as the claimant. We made allegations of fraud and or misrepresentation, because the bank had, first of all, they had refused to enter reasonable discussions and negotiations with regard to their refusal to accept the note as payment of any provable outstanding liability. Following that, the trustees of the trust they became aware that it might be possible that the bank hadn't actually lent them any money. So they requested full disclosure on the instrument of deposit that created the loan, or the alleged loan, and the bank point-blankly refused to even discuss the matter. At that point, that any and all existing contracts were terminated by the trustees, and the bank immediately appointed, without any recourse, because there was no enforceable mortgage contract, therefore no mortgage money could be said to have become due, appointed an LPA receiver to handle the trust properties. So the trust immediately filed proceedings in the High Court of Justice Chancery Division.
Okay, I mean, that's... Is there any way that you can, like, simplify that for the lay audience a little bit?
Yes. The bank refused to accept payment of the alleged debt. Then they failed to produce evidence that they'd lent any money in the first place. Then they attempted to dissolve the assets of the trust by appointing a receiver to handle those assets. And this left the trust with no alternative but to file a claim in the High Court against the bank for false representation and fraud.
It's amazing that no, I mean, if this has gone to court already, then it will have had attention on it. Why isn't the law coming down on the side of justice in this instance? Like, why aren't they just instantly going to the banks and taking them up for fraud?
Well, I can only really explain that through my own experiences. In broad strokes, when we had a hearing in court, the other side, the bank and the receiver, were arguing that what I put forward as representative of the trust and the power of attorney had absolutely no merit in English law. And they were applying to have the whole thing struck out as an abusive process. Now, I presented all of the facts to the judge. I was allowed to speak for as long as I deemed it necessary. I made all of the points that we've discussed today and many more besides. I cited all of the case law, all of the statutes in support of my arguments. And then the judge ruled that the unsigned facility letter, which was the nearest thing the bank had to a contract, which they were claiming was a contract and was legally binding, that document was signed only by the mortgagor, not the mortgagee. The bank had failed to sign it, and the judge inexplicably, in the hearing, despite the fact that I just said, it's unsigned, look, it's in the bundle, the judge stated that the document was signed by both parties, and that therefore it was an enforceable contract. He then denied me permission to appeal. I appealed to the Court of Appeal, and the process took 12 weeks. It should take two, but it took 12 weeks. There were two law lords involved during the application process. I know not why. That has not been disclosed. All of these points of law were in the application. There wasn't anything wrong with the application in terms of procedure and practice directions and protocols. And at the end of the 12 weeks, Lord Justice Lloyd dismissed as totally without merit the entire application and threatened me with a civil restraint order in order to prevent me bringing any further proceedings against the bank.
That's not the first time we heard of it either with the civil restraint orders. I guess it's a way to threaten people with sectioning effectively because, you know, to paint them as being mad.
Yes, yes, or a vexatious litigant.
Mm. Wasting the court's time.
Yes, yes, exactly. So despite this, we took a further application for permission to appeal to the Supreme Court on the basis that a standalone ground for appeal was the fact that the original judge failed to inspect the evidence correctly and wrongly stated that it was signed by the bank when it wasn't. That alone should have meant that the appeal was granted. And yet, the registrar of the Supreme Court, who was also a registrar of the Queen's Privy Council, point-blankly refused despite numerous points of law and procedure that I put forward demonstrating that the Supreme Court could intervene in any matter and make up the rules as it goes along if it deems that would be in the name of fairness and justice. Nevertheless, I was told by the registrar that it didn't matter what points I put forward, they were not willing to question the judgment of Lord Justice Lloyd, who by all accounts has already been touted as potential next Master of the Rolls.
And that's essentially corruption at the highest level.
It would be very difficult to make any other deduction.
It really would. It really would. And so we come back to the whole point of this, I suppose, which is that because there's not enough people adding pressure to this particular movement, more pressure needs to be applied in order to see some leverage of the strength of the public. So it needs to be an understandable concept that people can grasp. And obviously, a lot of people have mortgages, and it's a huge untapped vein of the sleeping masses who want nothing more than to be able to make ends meet every month. And the mortgage is the prime reason why they check in at 9 and punch out at 5. So how do we get that to them?
Okay. To understand the mortgage fraud, one has to understand the nature of a promise to pay. A promise to pay is an unconditional promise in writing to pay money regardless of any other circumstances. In other words, its unconditional nature means that it isn't contingent. Its value isn't contingent upon money sitting in a bank account. You don't need funds to back a promise to pay. It has value in and of itself. Therefore, when anybody in this country enters a mortgage agreement with a bank, regardless of whether there's an enforceable contract, what always happens is they'll sign some form of acceptance of an offer from the bank, and then they will sign a trust deed, which the bank don't need to sign, but they'll sign that trust deed in order to sign over the title to the property that's being mortgaged in the event of their default on the mortgage agreement. Now, every mortgage deed I've ever seen, there was a power of attorney clause. And in each power of attorney clause, it gives the lender the irrevocable right in your name, without disclosure, to create any negotiable instrument they deem fit in order to consolidate their security interest. Now, what this means is, in practice, is you sign your property away in a mortgage agreement, they create a negotiable instrument in your name, deposit it in a private trust account, then transfer the funds into the account held by a solicitor. The solicitor sees the credit and informs you that the money has been lent by the bank and the sale of the property or the purchase of the property goes through. However, that legal representative has no cognizance of whether money has been lent or credit has been extended. So that's an issue in and of itself. But in terms of the promissory note, you have already paid for your property, and yet they pretend that they're lending you their money at interest over 25 years. Okay, there are two ways that the money can be transferred. One way is by them depositing actual money in the suspense account, and the other is a transfer of credit.
Okay.
Because what we actually believe is happening is they create the money in your name, it's your money, but they pretend it's theirs and they're lending it to you. However, we believe that they actually keep the money or use it for other purposes, and they transfer a line of credit instead. So the solicitor just gets the credit, they keep the money, and they don't lend anything to you, they just extend credit.
Okay. And then you're locked into the cycle of paying back what you imagine to be the debt.
Exactly. You are paying back a loan that didn't actually happen. You are paying back money that was created in your name with your signature without your knowledge. That's the full extent of the mortgage fraud.
And this is going on all around the country, in most Western countries, all the time. It's absolutely incredible.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. So this, the situation we find ourselves in is one where the justice system in this country is much more like a miscarriage of justice system, and the laws, or rather the protections and the remedies prescribed by law, which are the birthright of the people, as per the terms of the Act of Settlement, the entire system, the justice system and the Crown, are in breach of trust. There's no doubt about it. The laws of the United Kingdom are one gigantic trust, and the people are the beneficiaries, and the courts and the judges are trustees on behalf of the Queen, and they're all in breach. They're all in breach because we've established beyond doubt that even when you're standing only on the facts, only on truth, and you're citing legal authorities which would normally win a case hands down, if you are attempting to make a claim or a counterclaim against a bank or a Crown agency, you've virtually got no chance whatsoever of getting the verdict in your favour. Virtually none. And there's so much evidence that we've amassed that demonstrates that. So that led us to a point where we thought, well, what are the remedies that we haven't exhausted? And there was only one. Within their system, the only thing we haven't done is bring representative actions against the banks for this all-encompassing, devastatingly complicated and international fraud that they've been getting away with for so long. And it's only become so complicated to understand it because what they're doing is actually really simple. So they've had to hide it by creating this web of deceit around it. So no one really understands what's going on with mortgages. It's been said in the courts many times, the Law Commission have even said it, that they are in favour of scrapping all UK mortgage law and starting again. Because even after the enactment of the 1989 Act, which was intended to clarify the situation, still, the banks just aren't adhering to their statutory obligations. They even opt out of them sometimes. You'll see in terms and conditions that the banks issue that they're deciding that they're not going to apply a certain statute in this case, or this section of this specific statute will not apply to this contract. And they're thereby proving beyond doubt that statutes require consent.
And I think it's a given that most people don't read to the full extent of the contract stipulations that are handed out when they go about mortgages anyway.
This is another problem. We have to take responsibility for it because it isn't just about the deception and crimes of the banksters. It's about our complicity in what they've done because we haven't taken responsibility for our own lives and our own actions. And we haven't, as you quite rightly say, we haven't even read the terms and conditions of the contracts that we think we're entering into.
And it really is that simple. Above all, it comes down to consent. It's the underpinning of absolutely everything that happens, both physically, you know, practically, but also when it comes to this whole system of deceit. It still rests upon this fundament of consent, whether it's implied, assumed, or otherwise.
Yes.
And really just taking the responsibility of withdrawing that consent, of just taking that simple step on a broad scale, would actually bring it down without the need to understand the complexities that surround the simple truth of the deception in mortgage.
That's right.
And you know, the mortgage word itself, you know, it's gone back to death grip in French. Mortgage is death grip when you break it down. So it's pretty interesting that they called it that.
It is, yes, no doubt.
Very
no doubt.
So yes. I mean, like, moving forward, then what do you perceive the next steps to be? I mean, I've been picking up the emails off you, obviously, with the banker busters and everything. What do you see happening next?
We're in the process of organising the first round of representative actions against the mortgage bandits. The plan is sometime over the next 6 to 10 weeks to file claims, actions against several of the banks on the same day, at the same time, in every district registry. And thus far, we have over 200 mortgagors who've expressed their intent to become part of the claims. But the beauty of bringing representative actions is, as long as you demonstrate that everybody pretty much has the same claim, you don't have to have the authorization of anybody that you're representing. In other words, if you have proof that your claim is true and it's happening to everybody, you can bring that claim into a court. Whether you're going to get the result or not, whether or not justice is going to be seen to be done, that's a different matter. But our intention is, and this is something which we're not hiding, this is very much happening under the radar. There won't be a big fanfare about what we're doing because it isn't necessary. We already have all of the people coming together that we require in order to demonstrate one way or another whether or not justice is obtainable for the people against the banks. And if it's not, then we have prima facie evidence that the entire legal system of this country should be declared null and void.